this grand anniversary conference. After 25 years of hard work, we in Bellona, one thing that we would like to do. We would like to look forward. Bellona wants to contribute to our work to make a better future. And it's time to start to use the existing solutions. This is a kickoff. This is the first day of the next 25 years. That's why the conference title is "The Future is Carbon Negative." I think it's that time to be brave. And several of you have been curious on what we mean with carbon negative. I hope we could tell you about that today. However, on a day like this, it's also an opportunity to reflect on our history. All the battles we have been fighting, all the results Bellona has achieved, all the hard work of so many good Bellona people, all the late evenings and all the fights, because we believe in what we're doing. Bellona now more than ever has become a necessity. Ladies and gentlemen, Bellona has proven that we can get results by engaging scientific work and to be able to fight. We will never give up, and I think our history has shown that we are quite hard to close down. We have proven to combine activism with the dimension of scientific work, the networking, pushing silently through lobbying, public by media. We have shown that we could create results. Bellona has always worked with the core method of being a good at handling large amounts of information. And that's challenging, because the amount of information is dramatically increasing. We were unique 15 years ago when we started our business cooperation program, because we understood that there were stakeholders in the industry who wanted the same things as us, and who is better to define what kind of framework and instrument that is needed to do the change. We have seen that as long as the rules are predictable, equal, they can be tough, the industry will manage to do the change. I think that a key message for all of you today is that you could get results when you work hard. And we in Bologna will use our experience and our credibility and our network to achieve results for the next 25 years. The challenges we are facing are enormous, and I will talk a little bit about how we get the numbers right. Because we have a challenge the next 40 years. And if I go back to when I was born, that's 45 years ago, then globally we produce around 4,000 terawatt hour. Today, we are producing 19,000 terawatt hour. Since I was born, there's 3 billion people on the globe. And we'll pass 7 billion people now in October. The global CO2 emissions are making new world records every year. Last year, 1.6 gigaton, much more than anyone expected. During the same period, the last 45 years, the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere has increased in 25%. In the spring, I was honored by the European Commission to ask, and I was asked to sit in Energy Commissioner Oettinger's advisory group, advising the Commission in drawing up the energy roadmap for the low carbon society 2050. We will establish and create strategies and policies in addition to the existing emission trade schemes on greenhouse gases. We will make a roadmap. We are able to sit at the drawing table and draw the future. That comes to order in order to live a decent life. This is a moral obligation, and it's extra for us in Norway. It's one of the richest countries with political stability, high education, and a lot of money to go forward and take our part of the responsibility. Well, we started in 86 to dig up barrels, breaking into factories and making a lot of noise. It was time to get the environmental issues up on the agenda. Bellona has moved from pointing at the problem to finding the solutions. I think our work on the nuclear waste has been following us for many years. We started just after the Chernobyl accident. We have seen what kind of problems the nuclear industry can create through our work in Russia. Since we started the mapping of all the nuclear legacy after the Cold War, and we made the reports that was the background for all the international security work, it has been spent $14 billion. And now, the Fukushima accident, probably worse than Chernobyl, costing at least more than $100 billion to secure, nuclear is too expensive. That's not a part of the solution. For me, it's important to say that when we look the next 25 years ahead, the environmental work, the environmental fight will look quite different from the first 25 years. When in 1988, James Hansen made his first arm, his set of alarm clock, in his famous testimony in the Congress on global warming. In 2007, the International Climate Panel came out with a report. And the report said, we have to reduce the CO2 emissions with 85% in the developed countries and 50% in the developing countries. That's an enormous target when we know that 80% of the energy today is produced by fossil fuel. They also said it's 90% chance that global warming was caused by man-made releases of greenhouse gas emissions. Would you like to bet on the last 10%, or should we create a strategy of this enormous international consensus among the scientists? In rich countries, we have to go ahead, because the developing countries will follow our standards. And I think that when we read the IPCC report in 2007, it was absolutely nailed out. We had to start our work and increase the targets we should achieve with 35%, because that was the difference between IPCC in 2007 and in 2002. We started in Bellona then a big report, to work on a big report in a scenario who said, the title was How to Combat Global Warming. It was a very inspiring work. And we saw a lot of strategies coming up. One of the things was that we were very much asking new questions after the report. What we saw was that bio was very big differences in the science on what bio can do to combat global warming. But we know one thing, we need more biomass. Because biomass is carbon neutral, and if you can produce enough of it, we could store energy from other renewable energy sources in biomass and make it available for transport and for the global market instead of just being dependent on a local electrical grid system. Biomass is carbon neutral. If we use biomass in power production with carbon capture and storage, we remove CO2 from the atmosphere. Or if the biomass is produced in the ocean, which is also a large territory, actually, it's removed from there. We could use biomass for coal firing at home. It could be biopower plants, it could be hydrogen production, storing the CO2. There's a lot of options. And biomass itself is finding CO2 in the vegetation and the roots. We need more biomass, and we need to be able to do that without conflicting with the fresh water or the use of agricultural land. That's a challenge. One of the biggest challenges when we also have to feed a growing population with food and water. If we had the luxury of having enough biomass, we could co-fire a lot together with coal. And coal could enable more types of biomass to be used for energy production. But the question is, do we have enough biomass? If we look at the aviation industry, we don't see any other technical options in a zero carbon society than biofuel. If we see shipping, biofuel needs to be a part of this. For me, that's extremely important to see what we can do, and we will later get a presentation from the International Energy Agency about this issue. And I think it's very inspiring because we start now to get results. We could use biomass in the industry, the cement industry, the melting industry, and we could do carbon capture. I say this because we need all kind of weapons that we have available to combat global warming. And we got curious when we did the work on how to combat global warming. We wanted to learn more, and some of that learning is going to be presented here today. That's why we have called this conference "The Future is Carbon Negative." I think that when we, in 2008, invited Lord Stern to speak at our high-level stakeholders conference before the Copenhagen negotiations, we saw the economic impact of not doing anything. And I promise you, the figures are worse now. Stern stated that he had been mistaken in the Stern report. He had underestimated the costs of global warming. That's quite dramatic. Maybe 1 to 2% gross domestic production each year could really help us in avoiding the worst consequences of global warming. This was in 2008. Simply put, we are running out of time. And I used to say, there is a saying, there is an elephant in the room, and in particular when it comes to the discussion about global warming. There is not only an elephant in the room. It's a lot of them in the atmosphere. Because if you calculate the weight of the CO2 that the rich countries has emitted to create welfare for 1.5 billion people in OECD the last 100 years, you have to put the weight of 105 billion elephants in the atmosphere. Or if you take 2 million of the largest cruise ships with more than 200,000 tons, that's the weight of the carbon we have put out in the atmosphere, and it's going to increase. I think that for us, we have spent in the rich countries the last 100 years emitting 420 gigatons of CO2 in the atmosphere. We used 100 years to create our welfare. In China, they used 20, 30 years to do the same development in increasing the welfare. Who could rightfully deny them the same right to a living standard? For me, it's impossible to underline. We cannot deny them jobs, fresh water, food, energy, because that will check the political stabilization in our civilization. we enjoyed living in standards of black holes. If we truly want that kind of development, we need to produce at least 3 times more energy as we're doing today. Today we are producing 90,000 terawatt-hour. If we should lift up the people outside the OECD with today's energy infrastructure, we need to produce more than 50,000 terawatt-hour. If we did that, and goes into the figures of US Geological Survey or the US Department of Energy, we will spend our coal resources and our fossil fuel resources, we will have used them within the next 25 years. And additional to this, 3 billion people more is going to be living on this planet in the next 25 years. If they are going to have the same living standard, if you're not going to change the infrastructure and the way you're producing energy, we need to produce 70,000 terawatt hour by 2015. The numbers doesn't go up. We don't have enough fossil fuel. I think that in Bellona we see the historical CO2 emission from the Western world as a bank loan from the hypothetical global carbon bank. I think we owe the weight of this 105 billion elephants, and we have to pay it back with a kind of interest. That's why we have to go carbon negative. Because I think you agree that no one of us in the richest country in the world, earning a lot of money selling fossil fuel, should deny or make a plan without taking into consideration that they're going to come up at the same level standard. For Bellona, it's extremely important to see not us all the economists, what is the cost of each ton. But we have done a bottom up of analyze and see what do we technically have of tools to do the job. Because whatever the cost is going to be cheaper than not doing anything and taking costs of global warming. That's not, it's not at the same calculate, those figures. Should we in the rich world go ahead and make use of that and be the early movers of the technology? I think that's crucial to achieve results. If you don't take it seriously, I think that for us in Bologna, reading the latest environmental science on climate change, we see the reports coming in to the next IPCC report. And Bellona has never been an organization talking about real estate. But I would like to use this opportunity to tell you all that the figures we are getting in is dramatic. They are much worse than the figures put into the IPCC report in 2007. This goes faster and it's bigger than we expected. And what do we do if James Hansen is right? Do we have an exit strategy? That's what we're going to present for you today. For Bellona, fighting 25 years, we've proven that it's possible to create changes by pressure. More than ever, there is a need for the law, because more than ever, it's a need for changes. I used to say, when we see the challenges, it's not allowed within the law to think small thoughts. We have to think big. And that's challenging, but it's also inspiring. Bellona wants to create 4 times more energy globally in order to create acceptable living standards for everyone within the year 2050 and cut the CO2 emissions at the same time. We need to change lifestyle in the Western world. We need to deploy energy efficiency in all new and existing buildings, and also in the industry, in the power production, in the ships. We need to be energy efficient and use the energy smartly. We need a massive And we need to use the last existing fossil fuels with CCS to produce the energy needed for large-scale production of solar. And then we need to produce biomass to store the energy from wind, solar, and so on, so we could export it to the global market. This is the age for the industrialization of environmental solutions. And today, we really start. We have to capture and store all the CO2 emissions from the 5,000 big stationary facilities that is located with a storage possibility. We have to rebuild them to be able to co-fire with biomass. It's 2,000 of these 5,000 stationary sources is gas power plants. That's why Bellona is so furious on the Norwegian government delaying the CCS at Mongstad. Because we need this technology. And 5 years is a long time in a 40 years perspective. We don't have that time to lose. Through our work in Europe, we started our first carbon capture hearing in the European Parliament back in 2004. We are now in the board of the technology platform for carbon capture and storage. We are the board for the technology platform for biofuel, and the Commission have asked us also to run a task force, which I'm sharing, and Bellona is the secretariat, for bio-CCS. We are very, very happy with this incentive. Additional to that, with the work we're going to do for the Commissioner Oettinger the following years, I think it's important to tell that have managed to get results. We have got a program for building 6 to 8 full-scale CCS facility within 2016 before Norway even made that investment, and we are very, very proud of this. We have got the security rules for storage in place, and we work together with the industry and we achieve results. These achievements are important milestones and indeed has created an arena for Bellona to work with carbon negative solutions. And it's quite crucial because in my mind I would be happy to solve the global problems with solar, wind, bio. But if we have taken away parts of the coal infrastructure, we have also taken away, it could be possible that we have taken away one of the biggest tools. They are the biggest emitters today, but by going carbon negative, we could suck out the CO2 from the atmosphere if we do this right. Then the next question is, where do we get all this biomass from? And that's a challenge, and that's a wide scope of science with different results. But through our work, we saw one thing. We cannot spend all the freshwater resources on producing all this biomass. We need to use seawater. And that's what we're going to get more information about today when we're going to talk about the Sahara First project. And maybe it will be a conference in a couple of years from Bellona's time where we also talk about the ocean forest project. Because the theoretical potential is enormous, and very few has been curious and dig into. And that is one of our privileges in Bellona. It's that we are able to dig into these kind of issues. I'm so eager to tell you about the Sahara First project because after 25 years, this project inspired me more than ever to continue because I see that we make a difference. I hope you all will be inspired. I just want to underline that our carbon negative solutions is not an excuse to continue as we are doing. We need carbon negative solutions additional to the tools we already have. By putting up such a hard target, Bellona achieves a kind of benchmark example, been working with fuel cells and liquid natural gas on supply ships. But that's fossil fuel. The only reason why we could do this is that we see fuel cells is the most energy efficient form for a ship. And from a theoretical point of view, if we have enough biomass, we could produce bioenergy. Then LNG maybe is not a roadblock towards a carbon negative society. And we benchmark all our ideas up to see if they're blackjacked or if they take us all the way to the goal. I used to say that Norway is a nice little country of petroholics. There are 5 million people having the income of around 2.7% of all the global CO2 emission, which is the result of the burned oil and gas we are exporting. We are now owning the biggest money in the world through our pension fund. And I think that we in Bellona, we know that money talks. We have now invested 3,100 billion crores in the world business. We own through the pension fund 1% of all the shares globally. And Bellona has spent a lot of time to try to influence the pension fund, both with negative screening and active investment. But for me, it's also a question who we would like to be when we have invested 1.5% in the company that owns Fukushima, when we have invested so much in BP during the Deepwater Horizon. I think one of the most important political discussions in Norway is how are we going to use this money. The financial world is watching us, and this is one of the things we are getting most interested about. In a panel discussion I had with Charlie from IPCC in Copenhagen during COP15, he stated that carbon negative strategies has to be a part of the fifth assessment report in 2013. But the lack of proven and good scientific material is worrying Bellona, and that's why we are so keen in collecting all kind of information we can achieve to support this work. Last week, the leader of United Nations climate negotiations, Cristiano Figueres, introduced the climate talks in Bonn. Wait, we have to develop technologies that could suck out CO2 from the atmosphere. Wow, we've been working with this for six, seven years now in Bologna, and that's set the title for this conference. It's not only Bologna. I met Figueres and Climate Commissioner Conheiro 3 weeks ago, and we discussed what kind of opportunities this creates. We have used this day to tell you about this option. Also, because this kind of thinking can maybe move the climate negotiations that has stopped up. Because maybe in the future, a part of climate agreements could be that rich countries like Europe commit themselves to climate reductions by buying sustainable renewable energy from developing countries to be able to go carbon negative and pay back our backlog. I think that is the window, and 3 billion people needs a job to come in 15, 20 years. Should we compete them out with cheap oil from the Arctic, or should we commit ourselves to buy energy from them? I've been an environmentalist since I was a teenager in the mid-70s. After having seen what we have achieved during the last 25 years with limited resources, because we have limited resources, we have, especially compared with the task I don't say that we have to go carbon negative everywhere, but we have to create strategies that is not blocking for such solutions. When Norway is using their time in the European Union to negotiate down the target the Renewable Energy Directive will have for our country, and at the same time promotes selling a lot of Norwegian gas to replace coal, we don't know if it really will replace, that's the receipt for temperature increase 3.5 degrees. That's the way we go forward with, if we would like to destroy our civilization as we know it today. I think that's a very, very challenging task for the Norwegian government. And they have really the realities in climate change into their politics. They don't have the right sense of urgency in this issue. We, in Bellona, we would like to be clear. We will continue to cry out on what we are against, because it's also a part of the solution to be against emissions from oil activity, coal activity, and so on. But we are looking forward to fight for all the solutions we see. We bought our first electrical car back in 89. And I have a dream that one day I will be able to drive my car, charge from a biopower plant, driven, powered by algae from Sahara, with carbon capture and storage. Each kilometer I drive, I remove CO2 from the atmosphere and I create welfare in the developing countries. And we have the technologies. It's a question about, do we really would like to make use of that? And we are now moving into the age where the decision the politicians do affect everything with us the next 40 years. Because now it's time, it's our time more than ever to do the changes. It seems maybe to be a long period towards 2050. But my youngest son will be younger than I am now in 2050. I'm scared. I'm really, really scared on the global warming information we get the last couple of years. But I am inspired. We have the solutions. We can make use of them. We have to make political framework that makes the solutions commercial. We have to industrialize the solutions. We in Bellona know through our 25 years that we can create results. Failure is no option, and the best way